فؤادك الأيام فتى.
عدد of the sky. Mm-hmm. Its water, ma'uhu abyadu min al-laban. Ma'uhu, the water of it, abyadu is more whiter than milk. Wa ahla min al-asal, and it tastes more greater than honey. Man shariba minhu sharbatan, anyone who drinks from it, lam yadhma ba'daha abadan, he will never be thirsty ever after that. That's what the Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said in his kitab Usul al-Sunnah, he said, والإيمان بالحوض, to believe in the حوض, it's from عقيدة أهل السنة. وأن لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حوضا يوم القيامة تلد عليه أمته, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has a fountain the day of judgment that the people will come to. عرضه مثل طوله, its length is like its, مسيره شهر آنية كعدد النجوم, its utensils is like the stars, the number of the stars, so much there. على ما صحت به الأخبار من غير وجه, as the authentic narrations have said from more than one source, from more than one source. So we believe in what? That our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has a hawd. He has a hawd, a fountain in which the righteous people are going to drink from. Who are the people who are not going to go to it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in the hadith that Imam al-Bukhari narrated in hadith Abi Hurairah. He said, بينما أنا قائم على حوضي, as I am standing on my fountain, I'm there. The Prophet ﷺ said, إذ أقبل رجل من أمتي أعرفهم, a people from my ummah who I recognize that they are from my ummah will make their way. حتى إذا هممت أن أناولهم, and then the Prophet says, I try to take the person by the hand so I can bring them towards my fountain. And then خرج رجل من بيني وبينهم, a person comes between me and them. وقال, he said, هلوما come. فأقول, I say, إلى أين, to where? فيقول, إلى النار والله. It said to me, the hellfire. That these people, leave them, they're going to be taken to the hellfire. فأقول, I then say, إنهم من أصحابي, they are my followers, they are my people, they are my ummah. فيقول, it then said to them, إنك لا تدري ما أحدثوا بعدك, you do not know what they have introduced after you, innovation after innovations they started to do. فإنهم لم يزالوا منحرفين على أعقاب منذ فارقتهم, when you left them and you turned your back on them, they diverted, they deviated from the path which you knew them upon, and they became something else. In another wording, the hadith says what? In another wording, the hadith says, إنهم بدلوا بعدك, after you they changed. The Prophet then says, سحقاً سحقاً لمن بدل بعدي, destruction, destruction be to the one who changes the religion after me. And so that's where they go. نعم.
وشفاعة حق.
The intercession is حق. Intercession is حق. And the intercessions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, first of all, the intercession here that the Shaykh is speaking about is that which is specific to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there are three types of shafa'ah that are specific to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are three levels of that. The first one is ash-shafa'atu fi fasl al-qada. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's intercession at the place of judging, when the judging is taking place and Allah is judging, he fi fasl al-qada, for Allah to judge the people subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the one that the people go to Adam alayhi salam, and they go to Nuh alayhi salam, and they come to Ibrahim, and then Musa, and then Isa. Each and every one of them passes it over until they come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, and then he says, ana laha, ana laha, it's mine, it's mine. And then the Prophet, he asks Allah to judge between the two people. The second one is what? That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam intercesses and he asks Allah tabarak wa ta'ala for Jannah to be opened. And that's the hadith narrated by Imam Muslim rahimahullah on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an. And the hadith is, أَتَى قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَتِي بَابَ الْجَنَّةِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, I will come the day of judgment to the door of Jannah, فَأَسْتَفْتِحُ, and I open it. فَيَقُولُ الْخَازِنُ, the Khazin, the person who is the guard of Jannah, will say to me, مَنْ أَنْتَ, who are you? فَأَقُولُ, I will say, مُحَمَّدٌ, and then he will say to me, بِكَ أُمِرْتُ, you are the one who I was ordered to open it for, لا أفتح لأحد قبلك. And I was told that I will not open it for anybody before you. You're the one who I open it for first. The third one is what? The intercession for the punishment to be lessened for his uncle Abu Talib. The one that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Allah what? For the naru jahannam to be lessened for Abu Talib. You see, Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the Prophet's uncle, came to the Prophet one day. And then he said to him, مَا أَغْنَيْتَ عَنْ عَمِّكَ. How have you supported? How have you aided? How have you shown support towards your uncle Abu Talib? فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ يَحُوطُكَ وَيَغْضِبُ لَكَ. He was one who treasured and cared for you. And he was one who we used to get angry for you if somebody said something to you or did something to you. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, هُوَ فِي ضَحْضَاحِ مِنْ نَارِ. وَلَوْلَا أَنَا لَكَانَ فِي دَرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, he is in dhahtah of Jahannam. Dhahtah means what? He is a place that's closer from the bottom part of Jahannam. He's not at the bottom. Dhahtah means what? هُوَ الْمَوْضِعُ الْقَرِيبُ. It's a place that's closer than the bottom of Jahannam. The hellfire has been lessened for him. And then there are other narrations show that he's actually wearing what? He's been punished by wearing what? جَرْمَتَانِ, two shoes. يَغْلَى بِهِمَا دِمَاغُ. The two shoes that he's wearing, the heat that's coming from the leg, it's actually burning him from the what? From the head. It's burning him from the head. And his head is boiling. His head is boiling. Na'am. And those are the what? The shafa'a, the intercessions that are done the Prophet ﷺ. Ahlul Sunnah believe it. It's haqq. And they are all intercessions for who? There are other intercessions that are done by other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first one is a people who deserve the punishment of the hellfire. A people who deserve the punishment of the hellfire. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam does intercession for them. And so do the believers do intercession for them. And they enter Jannah without any punishment. The second one is what? A people who've already been put into the hellfire. They are in the hellfire. And so the believers, the prophets, the angels will intercede for that person. And they will be taken out of the hellfire and they will be put into the Jannah. The third one is what? The intercession of who? Fi Ahlil A'raf. Ahlil A'raf are who? They are a people who are between, they're in a fortress between Jannah and Nar. Istawat hasanatum ma'a sayyi'atihim. Their righteous actions and their sins both became parallel, same, 50-50. They became the same, 50-50. Good 50, 50 evil, the same. So what are they done? What does Allah do to them? Allah keeps them in between Jannah and Nar. So they can see Jannah and they can keep. And they are kept in a fortress, in a wall. They're not allowed to move. Those people, the believers who have entered Jannah, will intercede for them. And Allah's mercy will take them to Jannah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu. The fourth one is, a people, a people who, when their actions and Allah's mercy, the actions and Allah's mercy, they were taken to Jannah, the Prophet and the righteous people will intercede for them and they will be lifted in places in Jannah. They're already in Jannah. They are in Jannah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will ask Allah's intercession for them, and also the believers and the Siddiqeen and the Shuhada. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, they will say, Ya Rabbi, there are believers of us, our brothers who are lower than us and they used to work hard. Ya Rabbi, take them up for us. Those are intercessions which are done. Those are intercessions which are done. How many did I give you? Four, three were for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those were specific to him. And these four, it's for the Prophet and other than them. Altogether is how many? Seven. Those are the seven types of shafa'ah. Those are seven types of shafa'ah. The first one is what? ثَلَاثٌ خَاصٌ لِلنَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. It's specific to the Prophet. And the next four is what? مُشْتَرَكَةٌ. It's shared by who? بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ غَيْرِهِ. It's shared by between him and other than him. صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. نعم.
وَالْبَعْثُ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ حَقٍ.
The resurrection. Ba'th means what? It means resurrection. And it's from the arkanul iman. that the person believes after you have died, you're going to come back. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He's going to bring back you back to life. We're not like the disbelievers who said, زَعَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَلَّا يُبْعَثُوا قُلْ بَلَا وَرَبِّي لَتُبْعَثُنَّ ثُمَّ لَتُنَبَّؤُنَّ بِمَا عَمِلْتُمْ وَذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ زَعَمَ الَّذِينَ زَعَمْ in the Arabic language is what? مَطِيَّةُ الْكَذِبِ. It is مَطِيَّةُ الْكَذِبِ. It's the brother of lying. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He will bring you back to life. In the Quran, there are only times when Allah told the Prophet to swear by him. There are times when Allah told him, this is one of the times. Allah ordered the messenger to swear by him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look what he said. قُلْ بَلَا say to the Muhammad. وَرَبِّي my Lord, I swear by him. لَتُبْعَثُنَّ نُولُ تَوْكِيد. So what does it mean? لَتُبْعَثُنَّ أَيْ لَتُبْعَثُنَّ وَتُبْعَثُنَّ. You will be resurrected. You will be resurrected. So much emphasis. بِمَا عَمِلْتُمْ based on what you have done. وَذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ. What the matter to Allah is easy. It's easy for Allah to bring back soul to you again. How will it be hard for him, subhanahu wa ta'ala? How could it be hard for him? Rather, Allah has already done it. Allah has already made a people die in this world and He's brought them back to life. He's done it already, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how is it not going to be easy for him later? Allah done it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the upcoming situations. Four of them we know. Four of them, the evidence have shown. The first one is the story of Nabiullah Musa, alayhi salam. The story of who? Nabiullah Musa. When Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He ordered them what? To take part of after they were ordered to slaughter the cow, they were told to take that part of the cow and to smack it against the body that was on the ground. Allah says, فَضْرِبُوهُ بِبَعْضِهَا. Smack part of it with the other. So what did they do? They smacked it with it. And so what happened to the dead body? It came up and it woke up. And then he was asked, who killed you? And he said, Fulan killed me. قَتَلَنِي فُلَانٌ. And then what happened? ثُمَّ عَادَ مَيِّتًا. Then he went back to his grave again. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he brings it in the ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah. Na'am. The second time is what? The second time Allah tabarak wa ta'ala done it was the man or the individual who went by the qariya, the village. He went by the city. And so when he went by the city and he walked by it, he looked at it and he said, I don't think this city could ever be brought back to how it used to be. فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ Allah took his life from him. مِئَةَ عَامٍ 100 years Allah took his life. ثُمَّ بَعَثَهُ Then Allah resurrected him again. 100 years he was gone. Allah brought him back to life again. Allah brought his donkey back to life. Allah brought his food back, his drink, everything. He was looking at it. And then once he realized that, what did he say? I now believe and I testify أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ That Allah has the ability of everything. نعم. So when a person reads those type of verses, you should remember Allah's ability, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how powerful and strong strength Allah has, subhanahu wa ta'ala. However much you're distressed, however much you're depressed, however much hardship that you're going through, Allah is able to make everything and is able to take it away from you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number the third time is what? The ones Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the story Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah as well, that a group of people, they left from their houses. وَهُمْ أُلُوفٌ There were 1,000 of them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that He gave them life again. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gave them life. The fourth one is Ashabul Kahf. The people of the Kahf. They died and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala brought them back to that we believe it. So based on that, Ahlul Sunnah, based on that, how can you not believe Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will bring people back to life again? You see? Are you with me? Those are it. Also what? Also, Allah who created you now before any previous creation, is He not able to just bring back what He's already created? Is it not? It is. And the third evidence to show that Allah can bring back life to those who have gone and dead is look at the earth. Look at the earth. What happened to it? أَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَسَالَتْ أَوْدِيَةٌ بِقَدَرِهَا فَاحْتَمَلَ السَّيْلُ زَبَدًا رَابِيًا. This earth, it dies. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sends rain to it and then it comes back to life again. He's done that. He killed this earth and He brought back life to it again. And if you look at the Quran, the methodology that the Quran takes when he tries to argue with them, in what? In the issue of resurrection and Allah bringing back the creation, Allah a lot of the time He uses what? The current earth, the way it dies, and Allah brings it back to earth. Allah says in the ayah, Surah Yasin, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الْإِنسَانُ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الْإِنسَانُ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الْإِنسَانُ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الْإِنسَانُ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمٌ مُبِينٌ وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقَهُ قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ خَلْقٍ عَلِيمٌ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمْ مِنَ الشَّجَرِ الْأَخْضَرِ نَارًا فَإِذَا أَنْتُمْ مِنْهُ تُوقِدُونَ. This Allah is comparing it straight away to what? The tree. Allah is comparing it to what? The tree. Look at it. It was dead. The color changed. Rain. Everything. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He does that. Na'am.
وَأَهْلُ الْكَبَائِرِ فِي مَشِيئَةِ اللَّهِ.
The author now is talking about is what is the ruling of the people who are major sinners. People who have committed major sin. What is the hukum of the sharia for them the day of judgment? Ahlul Sunnah believe that the people who commit major sins, they fall under Allah's mashia. Mashia means Allah does whatever He wills with them. If He wants, He takes them to the Jahannam and He punishes them. And Allah also, if He, what does He also do? If Allah wants, He takes them to Jannah straight away. Tahta mashi'ati Allah. Anyone who dies on sins, whether those sins are full, they fill this earth. They what? They fill this earth. And they've done all of the crimes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "Walau balagat anan as-sama." The Prophet said, even if it reaches what? Even if it reaches anan as-sama, meaning it reaches the sky. But as long as what? Thumma laqitani, but you meet me, la tushrik bi shay'a. You meet me and you do not associate partners with me. You meet me and you do not what? Associate partners with Allah. The one thing that Allah will not forgive a person for is what? Shirk. إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. سورة النساء آية 116. Everything a person does, Allah will forgive if He wants. سبحانه وتعالى. It falls under Allah's will. But when it comes to shirk, لا. Allah won't forgive you for it. You can do every good you want. Shirk is the one action. It will nullify every good that you have ever done. It will nullify every good that you've ever done. So a person who believes in Allah and the Day of Judgment stays away from what? Stays away from shirk. Also stays away from sins. Because if the matter falls under Allah's will, if Allah punishes you and takes you to the hellfire, will you be able to endure it? The answer is what? It is not. You won't be able to. So take this on board. مذهب أهل السنة والجماعة, the methodology of أهل السنة والجماعة is that the أهل الكبائر, the major, the people who have committed major sin, that they fall under Allah's will. Why would أهل السنة mention this in their books? The reason is because there are a group of people who are sick, who take the people out of Islam because of major sins. So a thing that's a major sin that hasn't reached kufr, what do? They push it into the realm of what? Kufr. And so they make the people kufar based on major sins. Based on what? Major sins. And these are the khawarij. They are the what? They are the khawarij. Na'am. And we spoke a bit about what their belief is. The Khawarij are a group of people who matters of Iman, they've went wrong on it. So by doing one sin, the person is for them what? He has left a fold of Islam. He's a kafir. So they say he's in the hellfire forever. What's the evidence? بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً وَأَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. They said, بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً. Anyone who falls into a sin, وَأَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُ, and his sins encompass him, فَأُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. He's in the hellfire and will stay there forever. That's what they said, that's our evidence. Ahlul Sunnah replied back to say, by saying, telling them, and he said to them, the sin here is meant by shirk. Are you guys blind? بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً. The سَيِّئَةً here is meant by shirk, nothing else. Because Ahlul Sunnah, what do? And every deviated sect, this is what you're going to find in them. What do? They will take part of the Qur'an and they will leave the rest. يَذْكُرُونَ مَا لَهُمْ. They mention what is for them. وَيَدَعُونَ مَا عَلَيْهِمْ. And they leave off that which is against them. Ahlul Sunnah do what? يَذْكُرُونَ مَا لَهُمْ وَمَا عَلَيْهِمْ. Ahlul Sunnah mention what is for them and what is against them. And then they point out how to explain the other point. Na'am. What's the evidence to show that if a person commits sins or major sins that he falls under Allah's will? There are extensive evidences, but for example, is the hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim on the authority of Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said to him, Bashir ummataka, give glad tidings to your people. Annahu man qala la ilaha illallah, that anybody who says la ilaha illallah, muqinan biha qalbu, his heart is certain about it, dakhala al-jannah, he will enter Jannah. He's certain about it. He says la ilaha illallah and he's certain about it. Tell Muhammad, give the glad tidings to the ummah about this. The person says la ilaha illallah and his heart is certain about it, that he will enter Jannah. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, The Prophet said, وَإِنْ زَنَى وَسَرِقْ, even if this person commits zina and he steals, قَالَ وَإِنْ زَنَى وَسَرِقْ, even if he what? Even if he steals and he commits zina, he will enter Jannah. Another narration says that Abi Dharr is the one who said this to the Prophet. That Abi Dharr said, Ya Rasulullah, إِنْ زَنَى وَسَرِقْ, even if, after the Prophet said this to him, Abi Dharr, anyone who says la ilaha illallah, muqinan biha qalbu, his heart is certain about it. You see, his heart is what? Certain about it. He will what? He will enter Jannah. Abi Dharr said, Ya Rasulullah, wa in zana wa sariq, even if this person commits zina and he steals, the Prophet said, wa in zana wa sariq. Then Abu Dharr said, a second time, Ya Rasulullah, wa in zana wa sariq, even if he commits zina and he steals, the Prophet said, wa in zana wa sariq. Abi Dharr the third time, he said, Ya Rasulullah, in zana wa sariq. The Prophet said, وَإِنْ زَلَى وَسَرِقْ عَلَى رَغْمِ أَنْفِ أَبِي ذَرٍ. And Abi Dharr, it was said that whenever he narrated that hadith, he would always mention that last part, which is what? He made the nose of Abi Dharr be dusted. He will never leave that part. He will say, the Prophet said this to me. And that shows you how reliable the Sahabas were when they transmitted the information of the hadith. Then even if somebody, the Prophet said something to them, they will say, عَلَى رَغْمِ أَبِي ذَرٍ. He used to say that whenever he narrated that. Naam.
ولا نكفر احدا من اهل القبله بذنبه ونكل سرائرهم الى الله عز وجل.
اهل السنه believe that اهل القبله are who? اهل القبله are Muslims who face the same qibla towards you. Anyone who faces towards the same qibla, اهل السنه call it اهل القبله. So the mubtadi' falls under this. The sinner or the person who's fallen, all of them, we refer to them as what? اهل القبله. They're Muslims. They are what? Usat, the sinners. Na'am, Ahlul Sunnah don't do takfir on them because of a sin that they done. This is opposite to what? The Khawarij, who do takfir of them by finding sins on them. Na'am, who Ahlul Sunnah, who are Khawarij? The ones who the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَإِنْ أَدْرَكْتُهُمْ لَأَقْتُلَنَّهُمْ قَتْلَ عَدْ. Wherever I meet them, I will kill them, the killing of. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about the Khawarij and how deviated and how confused they are, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if one of you was to know, pay attention to this hadith, you will never find anything as powerful and as strong as like this when it came to killing anyone. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even the disbelievers don't have this. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if any one of you knew the reward of killing the Khawarij, he would leave off all actions and rely on that alone. He would leave off all other actions. And he would rely on that killing the day of judgment. Say, Ya Rab, this is what I did. If he knew how much reward he gets by killing the Khawarij. They are a cancer in the Ummah. When they enter the Ummah, they're a cancer. They destroy the Ummah. Naam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith, Sharru qatla. They're the most evilest people on the ones who are killed on this earth. They're the most evilest of people. Ala wajhi al-ardi, on the face of this earth. Sharru qatla. In another wording, it says, شَرُّ قَتْلَى تَحْتَ أَدِيمِ السَّمَاءِ. Also the Prophet said in another wording, طُوبَى لِمَنْ قَتَلَهُمْ أَوْ قَتَلُوهُ. Prosperity and success is for the one who kills him and the one who is killed by him. May success be for that person. It's a dua nabawi, prophetic dua, for the one who kills the what? The Khawarij. Also the Prophet ﷺ, he himself said, if I meet them, I'm going to kill them like the people of Ad were killed. What does he mean by that? I would nuke them. I would annihilate them. I will annihilate them off the face of this earth. Ha. I will what? What is it called in English? Genocide? Yeah. Ha. It's the whole nation just to get rid of them. Never exist. The Prophet said, I will do that to them. That one Khariji will never exist on the face of this earth. And then killing them physically is a reward. Also, what's a reward? fighting and are and what do you call it? Refuting their misconceptions and what they say. And if they kill you, you are the best of people to be killed. If they kill you, you're the best of people to be killed. Now, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah told us when he spoke in his book, his great noble book, Aqidatul Wasatiyya, ibn Taymiyyah said, he said, وَمِنْ أُصُولِ أَهْلِ سُنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ أَنَّ الدِّينَ وَالْإِيمَانَ قَوْلٌ وَعَمَلٌ قول القلب واللسان وعمل القلب واللسان والجوارح وأن الإيمان يزيد بالطاعة وينقص بالمعصية وهم مع ذلك لا يكفرون أهل القبلة بمطلق المعاصي والكبائر أهل السنة he said they don't do takfir of the people who face towards the qibla by the sins which they have committed and the major sins that they have fallen into they don't do that أهل السنة don't believe that when the Khawarij were asked where's your evidence that the person who commits major sins they're a kafir towards you. The ayah that I gave before, and also the following hadith, that they said that the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith of Muslim, in the hadith of Abu Huraira, they said the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن ولا يسرق السارق حين يسرق وهو مؤمن ولا يشرب الخمر حين يشربها وهو مؤمن ولا ينتهب نهبة ذات شرف يرفع الناس إليه فيها أبصارهم حين ينتهبها وهو مؤمن. The hadith says that there's no person who commits zina. Whilst he's committing a zina, he's not a believer. And there's no person who steals. Whilst he's stealing, he's not a believer. And they said, the Prophet said this. So he's not a believer. Al-Sunnah replied by saying to them, this person is what? It is a person who is mu'minun naqisul imani. It's a person whose iman is deficient. So what has been negated from him is what? The iman being kamil, the completeness of the iman is what's negated from him. Lakin not aslul iman, not the original essence of the iman. That's not what's negated from him. There's another group who also went extreme on this side, on this issue as well. When it came to the sins that are done by, and a lot of the ummah of Muhammad, the majority or a lot of them have fallen into this belief, which is belief of irja, murji'a. A lot of them fell into this belief. If you look at a lot of the statements that you see on Facebook and you see on Twitter and things, a lot of the people, they have that belief of irja, which is what? That anyone, if a person commits a sin, that the iman, it can't be affected by it. لا يضر, it doesn't harm, مع الإيمان ذنبون. Once iman is come, no sin can harm you. So what have they done because of that? وَجَعَلُوا فُسَّاقَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. So based on that, the sinners, the people who've committed sin, who have gone against Allah's commands, who are swimming inside sin after sin, what did they say? Imanuhum, Imanu Abi Bakrin, wa Umara, wa Uthmana, wa Ali, the fusaq of the Muslimin. Their iman is the same as the iman of who? Abi Bakr and Umar. They're all upon what? Bimanzilatin wahidatin. They are all on one level. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali, and this fasiq who's in the pub, who spends 24/7 hours in the pub, they said that the iman are the same. وَلِذَٰلِكَ أَهْلُ السُنَّةِ, they said that these are a deviated group of this ummah, and the salaf of this ummah used to refer to them as what? The majus of this ummah. They are the what? Majus of this ummah. Majus are who? Fire worshippers. They're the fire worshippers of this ummah. You see, where did Ahlus Sunnah go? Ahlus Sunnah said that the person still has iman. Who's that refuting? The Khawarij, who said the iman is gone. And they also refuted the Murji'ah by saying, but the iman is deficient. The iman is what? It's deficient. So he's naqisul iman. His iman is what? His iman is naqis. His iman is naqis. It's right. It's low. It's little. His iman is what? His iman is little. And that he needs to what? What is the problem that occurred from the Khawarij and the Murji'ah is the issue of iman, the matters of iman. The Khawarij, what did they do? They made every single thing in iman an asal. When we say asal, we mean every action, they made it an asal. You see, there's a difference you have to realize here. The Khawarij, what did they say? The Khawarij, they said that every single action is an asal. If you leave one action, you're a kafir. Every action in iman is a asal. If you leave any one of them, you're a kafir. Are you with me? The Murji'a said what? Everything else is not an asal. The only thing that's an asal is what? within themselves, they have different views. We've mentioned some of their asnaf and some of their types. Some said, you just have to believe it in your heart. You don't even need to say it. Some just said, you need to know it. Some said, you just pronounce it, even if you don't have it in your heart. Within themselves, they have maqalat. But they said, no action is ever needed. Are you with me? Ahlul Sunnah said what? Ahlul Sunnah said, all of them are an action. The qawl is an action. The action, the qawl, sorry. The qawl is an, it's an asal. The qawl is a asal. And the amal is what? It's an asal. Huh? Ahlul Sunnah believe it's asal. But not individually. When it comes to the amal, the actions of the limbs, Ahlul Sunnah don't believe that the actions of the limbs, every single thing is an asal. They don't believe that. What do they believe? They believe actions of the limbs as a whole. You can't leave all of the actions of the limbs. You can't leave all the actions of the limbs. You see, Ahlul Sunnah believe that. That the person has to do actions. He has to come with actions. And the strongest view is there is a particular action which Ahlul Sunnah narrowed down, which they said that it leaving this is a kufr, salah. Some also said what? Zakat. Some said also hajj. Four pillars of Islam. The four pillars, other than the shahadatain, the other four pillars, which are called the mabani ul arba'a. But that's weak. The strongest one is salah. Anyone who leaves the salah, he's left the action of the limbs, he's a kafir. The one who doesn't believe that the actions of the limbs, that the salah, if you leave it, you're not a kafir, he has to believe that the actions of the limbs as a whole is an asal. You can't just come to the Day of Judgment without no actions. You have to come with some action. Naam, it's needed. And it's a shartun fi sahati al-iman. And it's a condition. The action is a condition of the iman. La yanfaku ahadun. None of them can be left. No qawl can be left and no amal can be left. All of them are vital. Naam. Hada aqidatu ahli sunnati wal jama'ah. That is the belief of ahli sunnah wal jama'ah. Naam.
ونقيم فرض الجهاد والحج مع أئمة المسلمين في كل دهر وزمان.
Here now the author is speaking about وجوب طاعة أئمة المسلمين. Obeying the Muslim ruler. If the ruler is a Muslim ruler, even if he's a sinner, we still have to obey him. Even if he's a sinner, he doesn't have to be righteous. If he's a fasiq, sinner, jair, transgressor, beating the Muslims, whipping them, taking their money, robbing them, they have to obey him. This is the belief of Ahlul Sunnah. وَنُقِيمُ فَرْضَ الْجِهَادِ Because he said what? أَئِمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمِ Has he left Islam yet? Is he a mu'min? Is he a Muslim? Because he's a Muslim and he's still a Muslim, we're not allowed to go against him. We have to obey him. Obedience is needed. وَنُقِيمُ فَرْضَ الْجِهَادِ We established with him, what do we establish with him? We establish jihad with him. Wal hajji. And we establish with him what? Hajj. Jihad and hajj have to establish with him. Ma'a immatil muslimin, with the Muslim leaders. We do it. Fi kulli dahrin, every time. Wa zamanin, and every time. We have to. Ahlul sunnati, that's what they believe. You pray behind him, the salah. You come to the jama'at and the jum'ah. If he's leading it, you pray with him. When the Eid prayer, if he's doing it, you come, you listen to his sermon, his khutbah. You give the zakat money to him. This guy plays with the money, he eats it, right? Even the zakat money, he does whatever he wants to it, you still give it to him. What do you do? You still have to give it to him. Jihad, if he's going to jihad and he's embarking on jihad, do we go with him? We go with the jihad with him. All of that are done with him. Because of this aqidat Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, in his aqidatul wasatiyah, he said, يرون إقامة الحج والجهاد والجمع والأعياد مع الأمراء أبرارا كانوا أو فجارا أهل السنة بل